Today's Saturday, right? We are live. All right. On a Saturday. It is 2:59, not 3 o'clock, but hey, we're live anyway. Yes, I decided to come live because I promised all of you that I will be updating my CCNA volume 2. Okay. And I am. I just haven't finished recording. Okay. And I'm so excited about what I'm doing that I decided, you know what? It's Saturday. Let me just give them a heads up of what's coming out. Okay? I need to show you more or less, give you a brief example of what's going on. Good afternoon, good afternoon, good afternoon. Now, I'm going to share this. I'm going to see if I can keep myself in the picture. Okay? No, not really. Let me go ahead and put it full blown there. And actually, let me zoom in a little bit. Okay? Now, this is one of the things that you'll find in your CCNA volume 2. There it is, CCNA volume 2. Chat. Wow, I should have separated that, huh? So you can see it better. There you go. CCNA volume 2, chapter 17, pages 386. That's right. Page 388. Sorry, page 388 and 389. What's up, Anonymous? I'm doing good. I'm doing good. All right. The reason I'm looking at this, because they're giving you an example. Because this, the title of this video that I'm making, let me put my face back in there. Is about VXLAN. Wow, that's kind of small. Got VXLAN and Lisp, right? That's the whole new thing now. It's about VXLAN and Lisp, VXLAN and Lisp, VXLAN and Lisp. But because, you know, and I said it about the ancient ways of networking from 2019. I hope you got the sarcasm on that, right? 2019 was the CCNA 125, and then, you know, the following year, February, I think it was, it switched over to the 301, the 200-301. So that then, you know, the 125 just became ancient, right? We don't network that way anymore. All right. I'm doing good, sir. I'm doing good. Thank you very much, Vahid. All right. So I want to show you here. I want to explain to you this little whatever it is that they're doing here, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. But just giving you a heads up. I'm not going to get into too much detail, but I'm going to give you a heads up. Okay? Check this out. All right. So what do we got here? Here we have layer 3 switches, and here we have a layer 2 switch. This is what they call a common campus network. Really? Okay. So, and then they have layer 2 ether channel all the way across. All the way across. Now, these are layer 3 switches and these are layer 2 switches, distribution switch, access switch, okay? But what you need to realize and what you're going to realize when you look at the video, it's going to be in GlobeEd.net. This, I'm only updating the GlobeEd.net CCNA Volume 2. That's the only one that I'm updating with this information, okay? I'm going to be doing the configurations, everything, all right? I'm halfway through. I'm not done, almost done, all right? But I just had to show you this. You don't trunk. When you do layer 2 ether channel, it's all about trunking. There's no routing involved whatsoever. Zero. No IP addresses on the ether channels. It's trunking. You go into a range, you trunk it, you tell it what your LAC peer, PAC peer, all right, that's it. And then you trunk the port channel, period. But it's different from a layer 2 switch to a layer 3 switch, right? You got to do the switch port trunk encapsulation type, and then you do the switch port mode trunk. Where in a layer 2 switch, you just report more trunk. So that's number one. So you're doing from a layer 3 to a layer 2 switch, you're doing layer 2 ether channel. Okay. All right. No problem. All right. But if you have your Cisco Pressbook, please go to chapter 17, page 388 and 389. All right. And then they're saying that this is the root bridge. What happened to the primary root bridge? That's the old. That's the ancient world. All right. Because if you have a primary, we have a primary and a secondary, right? All right. So apparently we're using spanning tree, right? It says it right here, rapid spanning tree at that, okay? So this is confusing. This is where I can see where you guys are confused. Cisco's confusing the hell out of you. And your instructor is not helping you at all. If it's me, I am. If it's somebody else, I don't know what they're doing, okay? Really? No, okay? So if you're using layer 2, you can't put IP addresses on layer 2 ether channel, all right? I don't care if you have a layer 3 switch. And then they're saying here that using HSRP, because they state that in this topology, your distribution switches are your gateways. I can see you maybe want to use that as your gateway. Well, wait a minute. If that's the truth, if you're part of a VLAN, which VLAN is going to be your gateway? Because it's going to be a switch virtual interface. So you got to create an SVI, right? And this is a tier two or tier three? Looks like a tier two, right? Apparently, this will be a tier two network. This will be a working as a router and a switch, all right? And then your core routers will be somewhere up here. But again, HSRP is running. HSRP can only run on layer three switches if you enable the routing process, or else it's not going to happen, okay? All right, you can't use HSRP on it's for routing redundancy. Okay, you can't do that. You have to enable the routing. Just try it. Question mark it. Try it. Go ahead. Use a layer three switch. Don't enable routing. Go into an interface, which has got to be an interface. Okay, and not have an IP address. Not have an IP in there. It's not going to happen. You're not going to see it. You're going to have to take out the layer two functionality in order for that to happen. But okay. And also, they have it where it's true. One port is still going to be blocked. If you're doing layer two ether channel, if you have all this redundancy, span tree is still going to be alive and well. All right. Because again, I've said this a million friggin' times. Okay. Ether channel, layer two, or layer three, its purpose is not to bypass spanning tree. That is a side effect. Its purpose is to aggregate the ports to increase your bandwidth, right? Which is really load balancing, but you're aggregating it for more bandwidth. The side effect of that is that you bypass spanning tree. But in layer two, since you're not routing, you will fall into that spanning tree blocking a port. Okay, so that is what happens in our common thing. But we didn't have any issues till 2020. No issues. A port's blocked. It's not going to go that way. We understand. We understood already that we wanted to, you know, route at the distribution access layer, or as they call it, the router access layer. But okay, so this is misleading in the book. Misleading big time, because layer three switches, layer two switches, it's telling you to run HSRP. So they're leaving a lot of things out because HSRP runs under an interface. Which interface are we running under? That's layer three, because they want layer two ether channels. No IP there, buddy. No IP there. So it's misleading. It's misleading. All right. So what you can take away from this, and one of the things I'll do in the course, is I'm going to break it down for you. I'm going to be configuring these things in the GlobeEd. Remember, GlobeEd.net, CCNA Volume 2. Okay, I'll be breaking this down, configuring step by step, all right, on why this is an issue. All right, so this is the ancient ways, 2019. Now, in the new way, we have this. They're all layer 3, right? And we're using layer 3. Oh, I should have put that. I didn't put that. All right, let me copy this real quick. Control-C. Let me control V right there. All right. I'm still here, guys. I'm still here. Let me put my face back in here. I'm still right here. Okay. Let me put that layer three. All right. So now I'll copy this. Control C, control V. All right. And then control V. And I'll put this right here. So here now, that's cool now. That's all right now. All right. So now we got layer three ether channel, layer three ether channel, layer three ether channel. Cool. Now, we have an IP address for our computers down here. We have a different scheme of IP addressing up here. Okay, we have a different scheme up here. So these are all routing, right? We can enable routing, but look at the routing that they want you to use. Go to page 389. It's right there. It's hold on. 389, second bullet. The switches use, I'm sorry. I thought you were looking at me. I'm sorry. I'm reading to you. I'm reading to you a bedtime story. See it right there? Yeah. Page 389. The switches, boys and girls, use the ISIS routing protocol. Okay? Which is the one that I'm teaching you. No one else's. Okay? And now we don't have a need for HSRP anywhere. We don't have a need for spanning tree because we're routing. That's cool. I'm down with that. I've overcome that stress. And now no VTP either. But remember, VTP was taken out due to the fact that they didn't know what the hell they were doing with it, because it's important. So now we're using layer 3, distribution, access. If you're doing an SDA environment, SDN, SDA fabric underlay type of thing, that's a spine and leaf. Spine and leaf. Spine and leaf, right? So let me bring back the picture. Bring that back the picture. So in this common network environment, still distribution access, right? Running layer 3 the channel, we're routing. So we not only have we created layer 3 the channels, which we took out the layer 2 functionality by doing no switch port, and we're putting IP addresses on our port channels. All right, different. Okay, and we're running ISIS, which is you need to know about the NSAP address, but that's why I did my ISIS master course. But on top of that, we don't need HSRP anymore. For what? We're going to have redundancy from hell. All right. So it's not needed anymore. No spanning tree because we're routing. Okay. And no VTP again, because they really never had any idea what they were doing with VTP to begin with. So, all right, cool. No problem. So we're using layer 3, but it gets worse. Before I show you, it gets worse, because one of the things they've reinvented networking. In the book, it explains, how did we learn switches? How did they learn about other computers? Through art, right? You learned it through art. Hey, who does this IP address belong to? You get back the MAC address, that's me. They send you the MAC address. Remember, because switches learn source MAC addresses. Create the MAC address table, right? Back and forth. Ah, that's archaic. We don't need that. So instead of going to the next version for IPv6 and using the ISIS protocol, we're just gonna make the frames bigger, and we're gonna change the terminology for everything. Let me show you. Get ready. So now our computers, or the IP addresses for our computers, are considered EIDs. EIDs, okay? And then we have the RLOCs, all right? Sounds like those things from the time machine, all right? What were they called? Somebody please remind me. So the EIDs are considered endpoint identifiers. Then you have the RLOC, routing locators, okay? And we have VXLAN, which is a tunneling protocol, okay? It's a tunneling protocol. Let me bring me back in the picture here. Okay, I'm sorry. Well, you can't really see that. Let me make it a little bit bigger. Okay, so this is your EID, your private IP address. These right here are your RLOCs, your routing locators, okay? These are the ones that communicate the different PCs together, right? That's these two switches right here. But they didn't stop there. They said, well, you know, if you're going in this way, this is an ingress tunnel router. And this is the egress tunnel router, okay? So, and we create a VXLAN tunnel, like a GRE tunnel. It's called a VXLAN tunnel. Oh, okay. Well, how are they learning? How are they learning the IP addresses? Well, they did something very good. They created a Lisp map server. Yep. So now when a switch somewhere is trying, you know, we're trying to get to a new switch. We're trying to get to a new destination, but we really don't know where it's at. Who do we go to? We just don't ARP. How dare you? We're going to go to the Lisp map server and send them a message. Hey, I need to know where's this person at? So they're going to look at their database and say, well, I got a mapping in my database of, let's say, you know, switch one. I have the EID and I have the RLOC, right? Well, let me send them a message and see if that's true. And yeah, it is true that I do have that IP address. You know, I have that RLOC and that EID. Cool. All right, man. Yeah, you can go ahead. You use this RLOC, this EID. You can go ahead and communicate. So now we're getting, instead of just ARPing our way across, we now have a Lisp map server that's going to maintain a database of information. Hey, my computer is going crazy. Okay, here it is. Oh, okay. I thought I was losing power. I paid my light bill, so I'm good to go. All right. So it's going across a Lisp map server now. Now, somewhere in there, I couldn't find it again. I think when I was going through it, it said that the first time. So I guess it already knows. Once it knows, it does keep the cache. You don't have to go through that again. But now, I guess ARP is no longer. Okay. So why are we, why is this? So now we got EIDs, we got RLocks, we have Lisp map servers, and the VXLAN tunnels that we're creating, because we need 16 million VLANs. We need 16 million VLANs because in our building, when we're creating these virtualizations, because everybody in the cloud, all right, because we don't know a lot, we have virtual servers in the cloud and all these different things. And, who here has millions of servers? I want to know. In one building, I want to know. You have a million servers? Where you go to work every day, you have a million? No, you don't. No, you don't. Okay. We were already routing in layer three. There was already people using layer three switches as their core routers. That's no mystery. But now we're being forced into this environment. And this is where the confusion comes in, because they leave a lot of things. That's why when I tell people, please take your CCNA, please take your network plus, don't go straight to CCNP. Because if you think that this was vague, this is vague in the book. This is why I'm updating my CCNA volume 2 in GlobeEd.net to break this down even further, okay? Because there's still people confused out there. Remember, I get emails, LinkedIn messages, all this stuff. And I said, okay, let me go ahead and go back. Let me see. This is why I need feedback. So I'm breaking this down for you even further. I'm in the middle of the recording, but I just couldn't help myself. So not only are they confusing you in just these two different topologies between using layer three and layer two, and layer three switches, layer three ether channel, layer three ether channel, which this is pure trunking. This is routing. Okay, so HSRP cannot be configured unless you're doing what? What are you doing? If you're doing a layer two ether channel, you can't put an IP address on this. So whatever. Okay, so now we got this going on. All right, and I already told you, ISIS. So I wanted to come today to give you that information. And this is just a smidgen of the information in comparison what I'm going to do in GlobeEd, right, in the course. Because there's so much more that I want to explain to you and break it down even further. So any confusion, any assumption that the book just left out, I can go ahead and make sure you get that. All right. So that's what I'm doing for the CCNA Volume 2 in GlobeEd, is breaking it down even further so you can understand that's not the common topology. Okay. Who said that? That's not the common topology. And if it is, I can see why everybody's being hacked. I can see why everything is coming down. What's up, hit up. You know what I mean? So definitely, when you're going through these books, the CCNA, whether it's Cisco Press, Cybex, Pearson, whoever it is that you're using, you got to do your research. You got to reread. You really got to know your stuff. Because if you follow the blueprints that they're putting out there, they're telling you to skip around. And I can't have that. I cannot have you guys skipping around, because you're really going to get into a world of hurt. I've told you already that Solaz, you don't recommend after CCNA to go ahead. No, yes. If you got your CCNA, yeah, go to your CCNP. Just know, and I have the book right here. These things are right next to me, okay? Okay, I've took out all my papers and stuff. This book is completely highlighted, okay? This book is like, I've rewritten it internally, okay? There's a lot of information that's left to the imagination. All right. And that's why you see those books behind me back there. See back there, all those books? Yeah, those are from the old CCNP. Okay. And the old CCIE written. All right. In order to be able to bring everything home for this one. Because this is supposed to be CCNP and CCIE. CCNP used to be three tests. Now it's, and the CCIE was a test on its own. So that's four tests. Turn into this. Think about it. Look at my Instagram. You'll see the picture of me holding the books up and saying, yeah, and comparing, because I told, there's a comparison that I made in one of my bootcamp classes where there's 100 pages of OSPF in the older book, and there's like 11 or 20 pages of OSPF in the new book. What happened? And that's the like the main protocol in the CCNA and the CCNP. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So there's, you really, you know, I do feel like I was in a time machine. I feel like Doctor Who, okay? That I don't know where I came out of somewhere. I don't know what happened, all right? When it transitioned over, it was insane. It was insane. But I really don't care, because I'm going to teach everybody everything. All the protocols, all the configurations, break everything down as much as I can to make it make sense, okay? Because, again, leaving everything to your imagination. That's why you need to research everything that you need to do, okay? Mr. Martin, there is no rush to get into the top. Take your time to learn the no stuff. Exactly. There is no rush. There's no rush, but you do got to make this year. We're already towards the end of March, right? Today is 3/20. We're always toward the end of March. March is almost over. How ready are you for your CCNA or your Network Plus or whichever certification you're taking? Okay, because I don't care which certification you're going to take. I mean, you got to take what you love, right? If you want to go the CCNA route, great. If you're taking your Network Plus, you take your CCNA, you go for your CCNP. There's no, I'm not saying to rush it, but don't procrastinate either. And do not let fear prevent you or you doubting yourself on what you know to get your certification. And that's why I tell everybody, you know, you guys on YouTube and Instagram, I tell everybody, it's not the same what you do at work than when you're taking a test. And the example that or the analogy that I like to use is Microsoft. It doesn't say choose two. It says choose the best answer. So all of them could be correct. But what is the Microsoft answer? That's the whole key to this. Okay. And it's turning into that. It's 102 questions, 1 minute and 17 seconds per question. Okay. And all's fair in love and war. All's fair in love and war. And they're going to come in here and they're going to do that to you. So you definitely got to get to it. And as far as rushing, nobody should be rushing. Nobody should be rushing. You should be taking your time. You should be segmenting. I've been telling you this. You should be segmenting your day and say, okay, I go to work. I give an example. I go to work from 9 to 5. When I come home, what do? If you're married and you have kids and what have you, you know, you live with your family, whatever, a little family time, you know, 1 hour, 2 hours, then it's time to hit the books. It's time to start doing your labs. It's 24 hours in a day. 3 to 5 hours sleep is all you need. Okay, that's it. You don't need 8 hours of sleep. What I told you that is lie to you. Okay? I don't get 8 hours of sleep. All right? I literally got to take, have you heard of those sleep gummies? I take sleep gummies, all right, in order to get me to sleep because my brain is nonstop. I wake up thinking about stuff like this, okay? Because this year, with everything that's going on in the world, okay, we need to make sure we get ourselves right, all right? I think I told you guys this already, that my Cisco Daily Planet newspaper that comes out twice a day, in the morning and at night, all right, the data center that holds the company, I think it's called paper.li, Paperly, right? They're the ones that put all their stuff, I'm putting everything to the cloud. I'm just going to let that data center handle everything for me. I'm not going to back up crap. The whole data center caught on fire, all right? All right, around the world, everybody around the world was down for 3 friggin' days, I believe. Okay, 3 days they were down because of the data center catching on fire. Correct me if I'm wrong. Don't we have countermeasures when IT departments, right, or you know, in telecommunications, we have these huge, I don't know, they suck up the air or special type of like fire stuff, whatever. That so things don't catch on fire, it's out in a second, and they get inspected every month. How did the whole data center catch on fire? How was that even possible? How did that happen? Okay, so things happen in IT that there's no explanation for. There really isn't. Some of the things you're like, listen, man, it is what it, I don't know. It is what it is. It happens. You fix it. Great. Move on. Write it down in your database of knowledge and move forward. But what I'm trying to say is that look at me. My paper was down for 3 days. And there are certain things that are going to slow you down along the way. All right. Issues. I made a while back ago, I made a statement about that I tried to print something out for the bootcamp for the things that I was going to do. And it wouldn't print. I tried everything in my power to make it print. It printed like weeks later or days later or what have you. I'm like, what in the world is going on? It's an old printer. So, okay, whatever. That's just the way it is. But one of the biggest things, because you're in a rush, since Martin mentioned it, do I have to do Network Plus if I do CCNA labs, or I can go ahead with the CCNP? Anonymous, just with that word, if you do belong to that organization, you're good to go for the CCNP. But I think if you take my CCNA, you should be good to go. All right. I don't want you skipping because they do not teach you IP. They do not teach you a lot of things in the CCNP. They take a lot of things into assumption. All right. They assume that you already know certain things. And I'll give you a very good example. Okay. When I took my boot camp, all right, for my CCIE hands-on, all right, which was 2 weeks, I believe it was 10 hours a day, I don't know, it was long. So yeah, if you have my Global Ed course, you're good to go. But when I went through that CCIE course, it was, my God, it was just, the amount of information was incredible. But one individual said, oh, they were talking about IPv6, can you explain IPv6? The words out of this instructor's mouth were, no, you should know IPv6 by now. I'm not here to teach you IPv6, just this configuration. That's it. So if you're ever in a CCIE class, boot camp, whatever, do not expect, and especially the books, do not expect that they're going to teach you how to subnet, how to summarize, how to work with IPv6. They're just going to teach you do this, do this, do this, and do this. Period. End of story. They're not there to teach you everything from before. And that's what's going on now. If you have no zero networking experience, you could have been in help desk and pretty much all you did was say, okay, you can't get online. You didn't get an IP address from the DSP server. Your net card went bad. You have a video card issue. Let me fix your Outlook. Whatever, your phone, whatever the case may be, but it was really, you never really had any troubleshooting network type of experience, okay? And you've never configured anything in the CLI or anything like that. You've never really was deep into IP addressing, then you're gonna be in a world of friggin' hurt. And if you didn't configure any of the routing protocols, RIP, EHRP, OSPF, BGP, static routes, default routes, you don't know what an administrative distance is, then you are asking to fail the CCNP. Now, with that said, I can tell you that there are people passing the CCNP a certain way, and we all know what that way is. But again, when you go to an actual work environment, you're not going to know anything. Okay? You're going to know it's C, but you're not going to know how to do it. So you got to do things the right way. So if you have my Global Ed course, so be looking for an update, hopefully soon, all right, because I'm already halfway through, okay? Look for that new update that I'm going to be doing before VXLAN and Lisp, okay? That's just the way it is. And I try to update all my courses as much as I can, all right? I'm doing a million things, and that's no excuse. I'm not going to use that as an excuse. But I want to get back on the topic as far as what Martin said. Rushing. Why are you rushing? What's in your way? It's not a fire in a data center. What's slowing you down? That's those negative people I told you about. Okay? Those are those negative people that are just in your way. Here you are being productive, studying, labbing, doing whatever it is that you need to do to move forward in life. Here comes your friends. Yo, hey, let's go out drinking, man. Let's go do this. Let's go here. I forget that, dude. You're working already. You can get that. You can do that later. They try to convince you. Why? Because they don't want you to succeed. They don't want you to succeed. All right? I'm talking from experience. I told you this. I'm not talking from, you know, they just don't want you to succeed. Bottom friggin' line. They just don't want you to. Because they want to, they're your buddies, right? And that's funny. You know, they're your friends, right? We have friends on Facebook. We have friends in high school. We have friends in college. No, we don't. As a young child, I was told if you make one friend in your life, you made a lot. Okay? Friend. A person that's going to be there for you 24/7. Whatever time they call you, man, I need your help. Man, I need this. Some people will take advantage of you. It's human nature to do that. Okay? And it's sad. And I've seen it firsthand. Yeah, man, listen. I think I said this story before. Okay? I think I said the story before. A millionaire. Yep. Thank you, Anonymous. A millionaire. This person is or was, because we lost contact, a millionaire. We're going to do business. This individual called me brother. I was family to him. I tried to do everything possible to help him any way I can and to do everything he told me to do. I'm listening to the millionaire. He became a millionaire. Heard his story, came here from nothing, had nothing, and made him and brought himself up. Awesome. Loved it. Was motivated. Took 20 grand from me. Just took it. Okay? Never did anything for me. I'm not bitter. Doesn't worry me. Okay? All right. That's what you did? You're done. Okay? You're done. You and me have nothing to talk about anymore. That's why I tell you, people will try to get close to you, okay, to try and take what you have. You got to be very careful. Me, I've learned, and I keep learning lessons every single day. If you tell me you're going to do something, then you better do it. Because I will keep my promise. I will keep my end. And if I don't, hey, Laz, are you going to put that out? Hey, Laz, are you going to put that out? And I say, you know what? I'm sorry. I haven't been able to do it. I've been doing X, Y, Z. I'm going to try and get to it as fast as I can. All right? I'm always going to respond maybe a little bit later. But remember, I got hundreds of thousands of people around the world. Again, it's not an excuse, but it's just a reality. All right? But I'm gonna propose this to you. This, what I heard the other day, I think it was on Instagram. It was an interview with Malcolm X, okay? And I hope I'm not trying to quote him or anything like that. I'm trying to remember. He made an analogy of a fox, I think, and a wolf, right? Where he said, a fox will be friendly to the chicken. A fox is friendly, so he can get close to you. And then when he gets close to you and he has you where he wants you, he eats you up. The wolf is the same thing. It's the same end goal, right? But the fox is friendly. The wolf ain't friendly. The wolf is aggressive. And what does he do? He just comes at you and you're scared to death, but you can't get away from him. And they just rip you to shreds, okay? And I'm like, oh, wow. So there's somebody that people can be friendly to you, and still all they're trying to do is try and get you close so they can do what they need to do. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just trying to be realistic. Okay? And friends, people think there's a song, friends. How is it? How many of us have them? Friends, right? They only come around when they need money. All right? So you got to be careful who you call your friend. We have acquaintances, okay, throughout the world. And you can't let these people stop you. The minute somebody says, man, what are you studying that for? You don't need to study that. You already got a job. You're working. You're good. You're smart. Okay? Backstabbing. Yes. Big time. Okay? And then you got to make sure that the people that are not in your mindset, get them out of your life. And that could be your family. That could be your friends. Okay? So, no. All right. It could be anybody where you work with. So you got to be very careful. You always got to be alert and listen for clues. If you don't believe in what I'm going to do, then I don't need to be with you. Okay. I have a goal in my life and I'm going to set out to do it. And that's what you need to do. My goal is to be one of the best instructors that was ever out there. And from there, I want to be one of the best motivational speakers. That's why I listen to Tony Robbins, Les Brown, all these people. Okay? So I want to be the best at what I do. And I'm nowhere near it. Okay? So I got to get on point. And if anybody gets in my way, if everybody talks negative about what I'm doing, that doesn't make sense what I'm doing, then I don't need to be around you. And I'm going to give you just one shot. It's like my wife, right? She's going to test you on the small things. If you can't pass the test on the small things, like grabbing me a glass of water when I'm sick, what's going to happen when the real deal comes around, when I'm dying in my bed? You're just going to leave me there to die. Okay? Last, my last question. I just started your course in GlobeEd. I study 2 hours a day. How long will a CCNA exam roughly? That depends on you, my friend, Anonymous. If you do study, hard studying 2 hours a day, if you're doing reading and answering questions, that's awesome, but you also need to do some labbing as well. All right? Do not, if you're spending 2 hours on reading and answering questions, that's awesome. Spend maybe an hour, okay, on labbing. You gotta lab. You gotta lab. But I can tell you, some people can do it within 30 days. Some people takes them 90 days. Go in between. Let's see, take 45 days. I have a gentleman. His name is Kevin Hayes. And he's had me for, you know, Network Plus, CCNA Volume 1, CCNA Volume 2. We had a weekly meeting with him. He's on the Facebook. He comes on my lives pretty much a lot of the times. That man studies all day, every day. He has that capability of doing that. But he studies, he labs, he has a Cybex, he has a Cisco Press. He's doing whatever he needs to do, and he has the Alpha Prep. So, and he goes into it, and he does whatever he has to do. And once he feels he's ready, then he's going to go take the test. Because sometimes you can feel ready, and then all of a sudden they throw a curveball at you in the test. And that's why I tell everybody, now that Alpha Prep is on a subscription, you got a 7-day free trial, get it so you can see what it's all about. Understand the type of questions that they're getting, that they're giving you. Mr. Prasan Magadnan. Okay. You're welcome, Anonymous. You're welcome. Was researching for non-blocking multicast, got non-blocking motivation. Was researching on non-blocking motivation. Join stream on right time. Good motivation. Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you. But yeah, so that thing of being in a rush, I think sometimes people feel they're in a rush because other people are slowing them down. And that can't happen. You can't let people slow you down. You have a goal, but a goal is just not enough. That's something, okay, I have a dream. Let's set some goals, some steps. Have you taken action on those steps? What have you done? March is almost over. How close are you to those steps? Okay? How close are you? It doesn't matter. I told you, when I got my certifications, when I went through school, all right, my wife worked full time. I studied for, I was a house husband. Okay? And we have 3 kids, one of which is autistic. Okay? All right? 2 girls, 1 boy. And again, I'm not trying to make excuses and, oh, cry for me story. Just telling you my reality. Okay? And I took care of the kids. She worked. Wherever I went, the book went with me. And I just read and read and read because we didn't have no e-learning platforms back then. Okay? And read and read and practice and practice and practice. Until I knew that. Until I knew that. Look, let me show you something real quick. I found it the other day. I never took a web design course. I can't be a web designer because I have no imagination with colors. I can't put colors together and stuff like that. Just like I couldn't put a hammer in it. I couldn't be a carpenter to save my life. I couldn't. I'm sorry. And I don't know anything about cars. I can put in gas. I can change a tire. That's as far as it goes. Okay? You see this book right here? This is old. This is old. Look how thick this book is. It's nothing. It's nothing. Where's the copyright on this book? I can show you. Well, I can tell you. I don't know. I'm not going to waste your time. But here it is. 1996. Okay, the copyright of this book is 1996. I learned HTML by myself using this book. The instructor that was teaching us, all he said, open tag, close tag, anything between goes... is what shows up. That was this lesson on HTML. I'm like, what? So I went to a bookstore that doesn't exist anymore called Dalton Books, and it bought me this. I was going to take like $8. Let me see. I'm sorry, I'm lying. It was $15, maybe it was on sale because I didn't pay $15. I think it was like around $8. I taught myself HTML. How did I do that? My wife, what are you doing? It's 1 o'clock in the morning. I'm doing my homework. I was doing it in HTML. Everything that I did from that moment on forward, because it was so cool. I had Notepad open, so I did everything in HTML. And I turned in my homework like that, okay? If you want to learn something, you got to dive in deep. You just can't brush over stuff because you're going to miss things. And then you're going to go to a certification exam, which their questions are out of this world. Not really. If you've gone through the Cisco Networking Academy, they're out of this world. Because I can't even understand an OSI question that they're asking. Because it's like all hieroglyphics. All right? The test is much easier than the Cisco Networking Academy. I can say that right now for a fact. All right? But you got to dive deep. You got to dive deep. And all the distractions in your life, they got to go. They got to go. Okay? IT, anybody that's in IT right now, okay, needs to, passion of teaching and passion in the platform is important. Definitely, definitely. That's very true. And this is the year that's why I keep telling you, this is the year you got to make it happen. But you, what Warren's saying there, you have a passion for it, all right? You got to learn to walk before you can run, okay? You need to read, you need to comprehend, you need to do the questions. When you go through a chapter, you read everything, you highlight, you underline, you put your little tabs, whatever. Try to answer it. First, take, if there's a pre-test, like before you start the chapters, take the test. See how you do. Okay, I got a 50. Okay, so you go through each chapter. Take each chapter review question exams, right? Take those. If you don't score better than a 90, do it again. Go back to the question you got wrong and read over that. And then move on to the next one, and move on to the next one, and move on to the next one. Every book, if you're using Cisco Press, you better have registered that book on ciscopress.com/register with the ISBN. So you can get additional videos, additional questions, flashcards, all that. You need to inundate yourself. You guys got to get away from the three foot side of the pool and go to the 20 foot side of the pool. Okay, you got to go deep. And you need to fully understand these concepts. Last, but they're talking about JSON and Puppet and Chef. Listen, you're not configuring JSON, you're not configuring Puppet, you're not configuring Chef, you're not configuring Ansible. They just want you to understand what you're looking at. That's it. Terminology, that's it. Are you? And listen, I'm the first one to say that I have my faults, because when I was going and I was creating Volume 1, I think it's in Volume 1, and they said it's no longer URL, it's URI. I'm like, what? It's well, back in 2015, it's the URI really that sort of organization. So it's really the Uniform Resource Identifier that we need to look at. We were saying it wrong since 1989. People still say URL, and we know what the hell we're talking about. But it's just terminology. You're taking a friggin' test. So I make fun of it because when I teach, I try to have fun with what I'm teaching. Okay? Because believe me, OSI can be very boring if you have the wrong instructor. Okay? And try to make things as easy as way. The easiest way, right? With like IP addressing or hex numbers. Or even when we're configuring. Like I tell everybody, I make a joke out of it. All right, we're configuring a VLAN, and I'm saying, here, all right, you ready? We're going to configure a VLAN. So make sure you take notes, pay attention, go over the video. VLAN 20, enter. We created a VLAN. Wow. I'm not making fun of people. You just got to do it. What am I saying? Albert Einstein once said, if you can't explain it in the simplest way, you don't understand it well enough. Exactly. And this is why a lot of, you know, I don't knock people, you know, professors, I knock on them because that's just who I am. Okay. Because all my life, you can't do this. You can't do that. You can't do this. You can't do that. I've always been surrounded by negative people. That's why in my background, you see me, I've been in construction. I've been in retail. I don't know. I need that paycheck at the end of the week. Okay. So they just kept me down until I met my wife, who's sitting across from me. Okay. Because I forced her to come up here into my office. Okay. And now she's sitting across from me, which gives me motivation. All right. And she says, you have the potential. It's in you. I got your back. I support you. You can do it. Because I didn't believe in myself. Okay. And she believed in me and she gave me the motivation. Listen, I didn't know how to type. I don't know if I ever told anybody this. I don't know if I told it on the interview that I had a couple months back or a year back or so. But when I was before this, before, way before IT, I was looking at the classifieds. I once found a job to become a forest ranger. The pay was awesome. I mean, for me at the time, I think they were paying like $50,000 or $60,000. They will give you like a cabin in the middle of friggin' woods. But there was a prerequisite. You didn't need a degree. High school was good enough. But there was one thing that, you needed to know how to do. Type. I'm like, oh, I can't type. I can't do it. My God, that's it. I would have been working at Yellowstone Park, living in the middle of the woods, enjoying life if I could only type 30 words a minute. When I told my wife that, babe, I can't type, she almost slapped me in the face. We went to Office Depot. We bought a friggin' CD or DVD at the time. I don't know, probably a CD. It was called the Typing Instructor Deluxe. It was like learning how to type playing games. Man, I learned how to type 30 words a minute like in a month. I would get on that thing for 8 hours a day because it was games. And now I'm typing what, like 90 words a minute? Okay. It's like, I'm glad I'm not a forest ranger. I'm glad I'm here now. Right? But I could have been, I let my typing. Think about that. I said, oh, I can't type. I'll never get that job. I can't. I even told my wife, I can't, it's telling me to put numbers. I can't type numbers. My fingers don't reach that way. She was a Bell, she worked at Bell South for 20 years, and towards her end of her career in Bell South, she was a 411 operator. She just looked at me like, just keep practicing. Your fingers will go that way. And just take practice, okay? Because she, imagine, I think if I don't know, she can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think she answered like thousands of calls a day for 411. Thousands. 19 seconds? Hey, what's up? What's up, big man? What's up? I haven't seen you in a while. Family's doing good. Thank you. Thank you. 19 seconds, my wife in 411 had to answer when people used to call 411. Okay. She had to do it within 19 seconds. So think about that. How many calls went into 411 in an 8 hour period? Okay. Thousands upon thousands. And she was able. Now, we need to know our limitations. Now, typing wasn't a limitation. It was a limitation for me. Why? Because people told me, nah, man, just put a hammer and a nail together. You can go ahead and do that. Just get a pick and break rocks. That's all you're good for. You're a strong guy. Just, you know, use your power, use your strength. And that way you earn your money. Sweat that money. Nobody ever gave me the motivation. All right? They've always... Way back in the day, you can't do that. Don't do that. What? That doesn't even make sense. What are you doing? You can't do that. All right? Just stay behind the scenes. Tell your wife that I said thanks to taking care of the alpha. Oh, no problems. Thank you from Raj. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Not until I met my wife now, didn't I? All right? That she's the one that said you can do it. Because she is an ambitious person. She will go out there and do whatever it takes to keep moving forward. And she's always told me, think ahead to the future. Always think ahead, but take steps. Don't just think about it. Do it. Take action. All right? And anybody that gets in your way, kick them out of your way. One of the things that my wife tried to do at one point was court reporting. Now remember, court reporting back in those days, I don't know how it is now. I still think they used that machine. Some people have like a funnel and they're talking to a funnel. Now in the courts, they have computerized systems and stuff like that. But back in the day, it was a little machine like this. It wasn't even a full typewriter. And it was a combination of keys that actually created a sentence. And think about it, when you say a sentence, whether if you put a period, a comma, a question mark, so I can say, hey, what's wrong? That's a question. Hey, what's wrong? I'm yelling at you. What's wrong? I'm indifferent. It's just a period. So whether you put a question mark, a period, or an exclamation mark, that makes a difference. And this is a courtroom. Somebody's life is hanging in the balance on your document. What was the prerequisite for typing for court reporting? Hundreds of words a minute. Hundreds of words a minute. Because, and your ears have to be open for everybody in that courtroom. So when the prosecutor stands up, when the defense comes up, you know, the judge says something, the defendant, you know, when everybody's talking in there, you got to get every piece of that conversation. So your fingers got to be flying because it's cryptic and, you know, it's not a normal keyboard. It's impossible. You wouldn't be able to type every word. So it's the keyboard combination that creates this. She says, yeah, there's no way. She was a Bell 411 operator. She can do that. But court reporting, just like me, I can't be a brain surgeon. I can't be a doctor. One, I want to be responsible for nobody's life. Can you imagine I give you the wrong medication? No, no, no. And by the way, well, you know, you want all my injuries, right? That I've broken the tibia here. Not the tibia. That's not the tibia. Tibia is down there. This I forgot what this one, this bone here was called. I forgot this one. Well, I broke this bone, okay, when I was a kid. They cast it up. Older, I should have known, you know, as we get older, we shouldn't be jumping fences. I broke this bone. This bone right here, I busted it. And no, I was so young, behaving like a A-core CPU, a stenographer. There you go. A-core, that's what court reporting is. This right here, I broke it. When I went to the doctor, you know what he tells me? He says, make sure that before you go into surgery, they put in a circle or an X around that. And I'm like, why is that? Because it's been known for surgeons or doctors to make a mistake and take out or fix the wrong thing. Amputate the wrong leg or arm. That's why when you go to the hospital to have a surgery, you see them marking the X. Oh, they look at your thing. Oh, you're so-and-so, you're this, you're that. They're triple, quadruple checking to make sure that everything is right. All right, because they don't want to take out the, you know, we took out your liver. Yeah, but that's not why I needed to be taken out. It was something else. Why'd you take out my liver? You know, it's mistakes happen. I'm not going to be a doctor because I can see putting in, you know, breaking a computer. Listen, I'll buy you a new one. All right. But I don't want somebody's life hanging on my hands. It's just not me. Okay. But whatever it is that you're going to do, and everybody's here because you're in IT, you got to dive deep and you got to tell everybody to go to hell. All right. Simple as that. You need to meet your goals. You need to meet your dreams, your aspirations. It's you. It's all about you and your family. That's it. All right. And when I say family, I mean, if you're married, it's going to be your immediate family, wife, husband, daughter, kids, whatever. Okay. But if your kids are grown, I'll be honest with you, if your kids are grown and they're in their 20s or 30s and, I don't know what I'm going to do yet. I'm still thinking about it. Well, you better hurry the hell up because I ain't going to support you forever. Okay. You better get out there. And right now, the way things are, okay, you better hurry the hell up. Thank you. Thank you, Martin. I appreciate that. You got to hurry the hell up because I can't support you forever. And there's a funny commercial about that where the guy's like in his 40s telling his old parents, I think they're in their 70s, you know, you guys still got it. You still can go out there, get a job because he's living in their home and he doesn't want to work. No, 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 no. Those people got to go. You got to set your goals because guess what? I'm 54. In the next 6 years, man, I want to chill. Okay? I still want to come online. I still want to speak to everybody. I still want to teach certain things. I want to be chill already. I want to have, you know, everything laid out. You know, I want to make sure that, you know, my family's taken care of in case something happens to me at the age of 62. Who knows? Okay? You don't know what's going to happen to you. So I want to make sure that everything is set so my wife, my kids, they're good to go. You know what I mean? We're good to go. But yeah, I have a goal. And I am lucky enough, blessed enough to have a wife that I have that supports me big time and does. And she, I'm telling you, what she does is amazing. But this is about you guys. Thanks, sir. I really appreciate your wise words. You're welcome. You're welcome. And believe me, guys, this is coming from personal experience. I can sit here and I can tell you stories that has happened to me that you wouldn't believe. And I was so easy back then. I used to work at a place. I'm just going to say this because I don't want to, you know, you got to be careful what you say now online, right? You got to be very careful, you know. I worked in the food court, okay, in a mall. And the guys that worked with me there, they knew how to egg me. I was so easy, all right? They go, Laz, those customers are taking pictures of you. So I'm like, yeah, they are. You sure, bro? He goes, yeah, man. So I go out there and I go to them and I say, hey, listen, I don't mind you taking pictures of the store, but don't take pictures of me. All right. Okay. And they go to me, I can do whatever I want. I'm a tourist. Obviously, I can't keep my mouth shut. So I turn around and I said, if you take another picture of me, I'm going to take that camera from you. Next thing I know, like 10 minutes later, security is in where I was working. And they go, hey, listen, they said that you were going to take the camera. I said, yeah, they're taking pictures of me. You don't know if I'm in a witness protection plan. You don't know what's going on with me. They don't have the right to take my picture. I got all irate. They go, no, come down. They're tourists. We got to deal with them. You know, nothing ever happened. But that's how I was back then. You know, I really didn't think things through. And everybody just, you know, they knew how to, you know, poke the bear. And that was so easy. And it was like, no, but let me tell you, as far as people trying to keep you down, I worked for a surveying company. I'm not going to mention the name. Okay. I didn't know squat about surveying. Those little machines you see guys looking through in the streets. I didn't know. All right. I worked for that surveying company. Right. Got the job. All right. You start off as a rod man. Then you go into becoming an instrument man. And then you go and become a party chief who's in charge, right, of your crew. All right. And there have been people there that were there for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, and they were instrument men. I'm like, God, this thing's got to be difficult, right? So I did the rodman for a while, got kind of bored, I was in a crew that would always put me down. They just, you know, they didn't want to teach me anything. They didn't care. And so they changed me to another crew. And then I go, hey, can I try that? Because I was always curious. You know, I already knew the rodman job. I was bored out of my mind. I was just getting a paycheck, right? So I went to, he goes, are you interested in learning this? I go, yeah, I am interested in learning this. Of course. Okay. And then he goes, okay, well, read this. Okay. That's that. Okay. Do it again. All right. Next time you're going to do it. I'm like, all right, cool. So they gave me the opportunity. I became an instrument man within, I was 6 months. I became an instrument man. It took certain people, there were 5 years still instrument man. All right. So I was an instrument man. Then I started noticing what the party chief was doing. What is he doing? I don't know crap about math. Okay. I don't know physics. I don't know all this geometry, calculating curves and all that. I didn't know none of that. But guess what we have? We have a calculator. It's like a little computer that you is for surveying, and then you just punch in the numbers that they get, that the instrument gives you, and it does everything for you. Right? And I learned how to draw with a ruler. Yes, believe it or not, I was able to do a straight line with a ruler. Okay. And I did my drawings, and he goes, oh, okay. Within 1 year, maybe a little bit over, it was a new title that they gave me, was Junior Party Chief. Oh my God. Well, what comes with that title? They gave me a work van that I can take home. I now have a crew that I'm in charge of. Okay. So I had, you know, so what I would do is I would get there earlier than everybody. I would put everything in the van to help them. I'm not trying to do anything to minimize them. I just want them to come to work and, hey, let's go. You know, you don't have to worry about it. I got the cooler ready. I got the instruments ready. All you guys got to do is just come to work. Let's go. I got my tires slashed. I got into fights. They tried to do everything they possibly could to destroy me. Okay. They say, Laz, the guy says you're taking their jobs. Like, how am I taking their jobs? Well, they said that when they come to work, everything's ready in the truck. I'm just helping them out. Well, they feel like they're not part of a team. It's like, okay, so from now on, I'm just going to come to work and sit my ass on the freaking van and let them put in the equipment, put in the coolers, put everything in. I'm just going to then, you know, just be the boss and tell them what to do. They could not accept the fact that they've been instrument men or rod men for 2 to 5 years. And within a little bit over a year, I became a junior party chief. It's not that I'm a brainiac, is that wherever I was at, I want to be the best at that. I don't want to stay just in one position. I want to move up. I got ambition. I want to make money. I want to live life easy. And believe me, they didn't make it easy. They did not make it easy. I remember we had to come in at 4 o'clock because we started early. And I think it was 4 o'clock where we had to come in. One day I came in at 2 or 3 or whatever it was. I don't remember the time. It's like an hour difference or something. Okay. And I know what this means. When they see me pulling up, there's one of the guys that was like one of the guys in the office. I guess he was somewhat like a boss, but he wasn't a boss at all. He's not even the boss at home. He started looking at his watch. And when I got off the van immediately, me and my big mouth, what are you going to watch for? I had nothing else to do. So I came in here and now we're going to calibrate the equipment. Well, no, you should have been out there. What do you want me to do? Go underneath the expressway like everybody else, wait till 5 and then come in? And he just didn't know what to say. It's just my attitude. That's just the way it is. And now it's really bad. Now it's really bad. But that's happened to me. Raj, I'm still struggling with Class B IP address. Do you have any more videos with more examples that you can work out? I am comfortable now with Class C. It's keeping me back from moving forward on my studies. Dude, just schedule one of the weekly meetings with me. I believe in the next weekly meeting, let me check my folder on the weekly meetings. I think it's in this drive. It's Wednesdays at 10 a.m., Thursdays at 7 p.m. I'm done with week one, the first. Oops, it's coming here. Open. Yeah, it's, we're doing classes and reserved and private IP addresses and stuff like that. But you can just schedule a weekly meeting with me. We can go ahead and go over with that. Just go to globed.net and schedule a weekly meeting. The course outline should be up there and I can help you more than happy to help you. More happy to. Again, it's the same format. I think if you look at, even if you don't want to schedule weekly meetings, you can just go to the YouTube video. I mean, I got a bunch of YouTube videos on that. And I have if you have my IPv4 course, I should go over that. But if you want to go into it deeper, that's one of the things I went over with Kevin. He scheduled one of the weekly meetings with me and we went over that. I know one of my other students scheduled a weekly meeting and we went over, it was again, based on IPs. Kevin's was questions based that he's getting on Alpha Prep. Kevin's very advanced. All right. So it was one of the questions on Alpha Prep, but we got it squared away. All right. But yeah, go to globed.net, schedule a weekly meeting with me. And it's for an hour. And in that hour, you'll do B and A. Like, you know, it's easy. Just schedule a weekly meeting. We'll get it done. If that's what's keeping you, that's a non-issue. I'll get you squared away in that hour. No issues. Just schedule it. Now it's Wednesdays and Thursdays. Wednesdays at 10 a.m., Thursdays at 7 p.m. for 1 hour. Just go to globed.net and we'll go ahead and take care of that. Okay. But yeah, so believe me, don't think that what I'm telling you hasn't happened to me. It's happened to everybody. But for some reason, Murphy's on my back every single time. Every single time. All right. And I've been in jobs where I wasn't always hated. I had my acquaintances. We had good. I'm helpful. I want to help. If I'm not doing anything, I always want to be doing something. I have to be active. I remember, oh my God, this is going, I'm not even going to say the year. This is going back. Well, one of my first warehouse jobs, okay? That's another story. I'm just going to tell you this one. It was a union, non-union job. I was not in the union, okay? Thank you, Sugar. Thank you. I wish, but thank you. It was a union, non-union job. I wasn't in the union yet. It was in my first 3 months. And it was a warehouse job, right? I was in receiving. So I would move boxes. I would climb up racks. I would drive the forklift. I would carry 2 pallets. You know what I'm saying? I was just a friggin', you know, just running around the friggin' thing, just getting things done. I was approached by a union guy. He's been there for years. Says, hey, man, you think you can slow down? I'm like, no. How about you picking it up? And they started talking crap about the company. So listen, I don't got time for this. And I just left them alone and kept doing what I was doing. All right, Sugar. Awesome. Get on it. Get on it, brother. Get on it. And again, LinkedIn, info at the Networking Doctors. You can get a hold of me. All right. I've always had a big mouth, but it wasn't controlled. Now, 22 years later, after meeting my wife, now is a controlled big mouth. Now I know how to think, because I'm usually a reactionary person. I'm ready to jump, right? No. Now I just think. And now I've learned how to think and then reply. Think and then reply. Because my first reaction is like, you said what? And I'm like, and then she goes, relax. Don't worry about it. She taught me that. You're a great inspiration. I thought I was too old to get back into the field. I think. Ross, how old are you, dude? Job is coming to an end. I'll work here for so. Wow. 17 years. That's amazing. So here, somebody in their job for 17 years is amazing. Thanks for all the great work you're doing. Thank you. I appreciate that, Raj. I appreciate that. You're young, dude. You're in your 40s. You're young. You're young, strong, ready to rock and roll, baby. All right, I'm 54, and I'm a 54 that's been on the road the whole time, brother. Okay. I got tread marks on me. Okay. And you gotta grow thick skin. You gotta do what you gotta do. Luckily, I come from the old school. All right. You can't really get to me. All right. And nothing's gonna stop me. And that's why I want everybody's mentality that's following me, that's in my YouTube, that's in my Instagram, that's in my courses, my boot camps, my self-paced courses, everybody around the world. I want everybody. Pay is good and comfort. So there's no need to. No, there's always a need. I know the pay is good right now. It could always be better. Always remember that. It could always be better. It could always be better. It could always be better. Do not settle. Listen, I had a sneaky suspicion that you're good to go. All right. That you're an intelligent, ambitious individual. Do not settle. I don't care if you're making 600 grand a year. I don't care. Or if you're making $1 million a year, you could be making 2 million. Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, this guy from Amazon, Jeff Bezos, all these guys, they didn't settle. Why should you? Why should any one of us? Okay? If I would have settled back when I was in high school, I'd still be making $310 an hour or $525 or $750. No. I learned that you cannot settle. I don't care how good you're doing. Again, if you're making 10 million, why not 20? If you're making 30 million, why not 40? Okay? That's your mentality. It's never enough. It's never going to be enough. You may be comfortable, you may be happy already, but now I have to move on. So I'm happy for your help and inspiration. You're welcome, Raj. You're welcome. And I'm not dogging you. I'm glad you're happy. I'm glad you're comfortable. I'm glad you're doing what you love and you're still upgrading yourself. But even though the pay is good, it's great, and lets you do what you want to do, it could always be better. It could always be better. None of these motivational speakers, none of these big tech companies, none of these people that you've seen, Uber, that guy became a millionaire overnight, all right? And he's still going, okay? Everybody's always diversifying. Everybody's always looking at different things they can do to make themselves do better. Due to the comfort, I've never tried to move up, but I am seeing it's coming to an end. Yeah. So definitely, thank you, sir. I appreciate that. All I want to do is motivate. All I want to make sure is that you guys get what you need to keep moving forward and diversify. Diversify. So if you're in routing and switching, maybe you get into SD-WAN, you get into security, you get into cloud architecture, you get into all these different things. Right? Keep your options open. Be moving around, but always, you don't want to be going, horizontal? You want to be going vertical. All right? Always moving up. Always moving up. Always moving up. That nest egg, it's got to be big. It's got to be big. All right? So when you get to 60, all right? Like me, I set my goal at 62. At 62, I'm not going to stop. But I can relax because I know I'm good to go. I already got everything set up. Everything is good to go. The foundation is laid out. Everything is doing itself. I'm good. All right. If something were to happen to me, my family is taken care of. Okay. And that's my concern. But it always can be better. And everybody on this channel, everybody that sees this, everybody that sees me on YouTube, everybody, now I did my Facebook. I did my christening on Facebook on Friday. That was funny. It was exciting though. And I started doing it every Friday now at 11 o'clock. All right. So we need to keep learning. We need to keep growing. There's no such thing as stopping. The only time you stop is when you stop breathing. That's it. I'm not saying to stress yourself out, but you're going to get to a point in life where, you know, okay, Elon Musk, you think Elon Musk is not stressed out, or Jeff Bezos or Bill Gates and all these guys? Warren Buffett, yeah, these guys got billions upon billions and hundreds of billions of dollars. But they can lose it in one day. They can lose it in one day. There's millionaires and billionaires that have lost their money in one day. But guess what? One of the things about the 1%ers and the 0.05%ers, okay, that if they lose it, they can get it back. Why? Because they have that passion and they have desire and they have that drive. I will not settle for what I have. I will always move forward in life. I will never settle. Now, you know, and I mean, it's not greed. It's comfort. People, you know, there's a saying that says the root of all evil is money. The root of not having money is evil. Because if you got no money, if people are broke, that's when you start thinking of stupid things. And that's when you start getting in trouble. Okay? But if you got money, life is good. Life is good. Okay? Simple things. My wife can go to the hair salon every week. She can do her nails. She can do her hair. We can rent a movie. We can go out to eat. Okay? We can go to the doctor. None of those things are free. I know I'm a good-looking guy, but they're not going to go ahead and give me anything for free. All right? And Raj, you're by the picture. I'm sure that's your wife next to you. You guys look, I can't really see you. You know, my eyes, even though I did LASIK, I still got to wear reading glasses. You look good, man. And so does she. So, but you still got to pay your rent. You still got to pay your bill. You still got to pay the pool guy. You got to pay your groceries. You got to do stuff like that. But you always got to be reaching to put yourself in a better, even better position. All right. The stress will be less. All right. The work will be less. All right. Once you do all the groundwork, all the hard work, and this is where all of you are about automation. Okay. Automation is where you become that real entrepreneur, where the business is running itself. All you got to do is manage it. For the love of money is the root of all. There's something Mike Freeman wrote. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils, which some stretching after have been seduced away from faith and have pierced themselves with many sorrow. Okay. That's, you got that from where? 1 Tim 6:10. Okay. I respect that. That's your opinion. That's fine. Believe me, because what I do with money, I don't give it away, but I definitely make sure that my family is taken care of and we're in a better position, because I want my stepdaughter to be able to go to the dentist. I want my wife to be able to get her medication because she is diabetic. Okay. I want to be able to pay my gym so I can continue to work out and get my supplements, you know, my protein, my pre-workouts and all that stuff. All right. And believe me, half my body has been operated on. All right, due to falls and trips and stuff like that, I got plates and screws all over my body. All right, so it's not the fact that it's a love for money, is making sure that I have what I need to take care of my family. If you don't love money, hey, listen, I understand. If you want to go live in a hut, because I tell you what, I saw a documentary one time. I'm not making fun. I saw a documentary. He was an admiral. I think it was in the British Navy. All right, he was an animal, but after his 30 or 40 years of service, he thought he was a leopard. All right, so he tattooed himself like a leopard. He put those things on his head, okay, and he lived in a cave in an island somewhere in the middle of nowhere. He had books, and that's all he did. To him, he was good. He was living off his retirement check. The only time he came in right? He would, you know, dress up not to, you know, so nobody would get scared or whatever, and or tell him anything. He would get his food, come back, go into his cave, and that's how he wanted to live his life. He was happy. But those books didn't come free. The candles that he used in the cave didn't come free, and his food wasn't free. No, I know he's quoting a book from the Bible. I understand that. I understand that. Okay, but and I respect that completely. All right, but again, it's not the root of all evil. And if you're telling me the quote, that's cool. Now I know it, and I appreciate that. But know that money, you, in order to survive in this world, is necessary. Okay, it's you need it. Okay, and I do not want to live in a cave. I do not want to live in a hut. I'm not saying I'm going to buy, there's no way I can buy a $10 million mansion or anything like that. But I want to be comfortable. And I want my wife, my stepdaughter, you know, the family to be comfortable where they're okay. And we have to pay for medication. We have to, you know, somebody's light bill, whatever the case may be. I want to be able to do that to help. In order for me to come to you guys, do you think my e-learning platform is free? For you it is, not for me. Okay? Okay? All the things that you get from me, or the paper, all these things that I give you, I got to pay for. This company doesn't run on air. Oh, it's Laz. Let's give him storage for free. Oh, it's Laz. Ah, just give him any application he wants so he can go ahead and just, you know, teach the world. No. No, it doesn't work that way. Everything that I do, I mean, I thank all of you because of you, not only my wife for giving me the motivation, but because you coming onto my channel and being with me, you made me. I mean, money is not evil. It's how you try to acquire it. It could be evil. Exactly. Exactly. Thank you, Raj. Thank you. Laz, Laz, I was just sticking to your Globit videos, so I have to read the book, the CCNA 201 and do volume 2. Do I really have to read it? Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Read it. Read it. And the reason I tell you this, okay, I've read all these books. There's one book. Let me show you. In my arsenal of many books. And remember the course that I tell you that I'm doing? I'm doing it. Okay, the Hero to Zero. All right. It's all full of tabs. Okay. No front cover. Okay. This was the 200-120. Okay. I knew every chapter, every page, every sentence in this book. Okay. Nobody can tell me anything. All right. So when the students went to take the test, they were good to go. Because, and that was back in the day where you were configuring. All right. Now that you're not configuring, okay. Now that you're not configuring, they can go to page 590 and they say, which of the following commands would put an IPv6 address on an interface? That's the page I opened that up to. Or they can pick a sentence out of nowhere, port security. Okay, I don't know, and just they can just open a book. Remember, Alpha Prep, they have a bank from the Cisco Networking Academy, 6,000 questions. You're taking a test that's 102 questions, and each question is a minute and 17 seconds. Brother, what's that memory thing that we take? What's for memory that we take? Mrs. Diaz? It's not Gingo Bicoa. There's something else. You replaced it with something. My wife, she does her research on all these different things, like melatonin and passion flower, magnesium, all these different things so we can take it so my memory can be whatever. Believe me, I take all these things. They got me taking all these different shakes, all right, so I can keep remembering. But that's how you got to be, Anonymous. That's how everybody needs to be. Dissect the hell out of all these books. So they can't get you like they say they will. They will throw a question at you that's in left field. Anyway, and remember the purpose I came on here. I know I started talking, you know, about a whole bunch of different things. All right. Let me share this one last time. All right. This is what you can expect. That's going to be, I'm halfway through the recording explaining this debacle that they have here in volume 2. Okay. And these acronym HAPPY. All right. Because this test is acronym HAPPY. I'm explaining that. This is why I came on because I was just excited. Okay. I was just excited about it. And I said, I got to tell these guys. I got to tell somebody. My wife should have been a CCMP by now, but she's doing other things. Okay. But I just need to bring this to you. So don't worry, I'm gonna be updating the volume two. All right, it will be there, I promise. Okay, just stay motivated, stay practicing. It's already March 20th, 3 months almost down. Year keeps going. Do what you need to do. Don't settle. Always keep going up, 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 and up. Okay. Thank you for joining. Remember, subscribe to globet.net. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. Go to my Instagram. I'm gonna be putting a lot of questions coming up on Instagram. All right. And what else? Am I missing something? Oh yeah. Please comment. Please comment on my stuff so I know. Liked it, didn't like it, where I can do better, anything. Constructive criticism. Constructive criticism. Let's be nice, okay? All right, but let me know. Let me know, okay? And you know you can reach me, info@thenumberingdoctors.com. Love you guys. Stay safe. Stay motivated. Okay, Michelle has using Stay safe. Stay motivated and do what needs to be done. Love you all. I'll see you soon.